Later this year, we have the release of maybe the least known Marvel property to hit the big screen with The Eternals. It might have hit some fans as an odd choice, but with all the time and space hopping that we witnessed in Infinity War and Endgame, I think it makes perfect sense to bring them in for the next phase of the MCU. But who are they? What are they?
Why is Gamora?
Well, here's a brief explanation for the cosmic beings before they become household names. Back in 1975, Jack Kirby made his return to Marvel Comics after a run with DC, where he would pencil, write and edit his own comics from his home in California, after working to help such titles as Captain America and Black Panther. But Kirby had his sights set beyond our Earth. Shortly before though, Eric von Daniken had released his best-selling book, Chariot of the Gods, where he presented the ideas of aliens visiting Earth in the distant past, influencing some of our cultures. Marvel took notice of this idea and decided to run with it, greenlighting Kirby's new book, The Celestials, which then became Return of the Gods, so it had a stronger link to the consumers. But they worried this may be borderline infringement, so the final title became The Eternals. The first issue was released July 1976 and originally ran for 19 issues and one annual. A bit of a longer run for Kirby at the time. Probably the most striking thing from these books is the artwork. Not really shocking when Kirby's involved. Considering the age of this title now, I was still blown away by the designs, especially of the Celestials. During the early days of life on Earth, 10 beings known as the Celestials arrived on our planet. They would travel all around space to observe life forms as they developed. This would happen over many years, with various delegations known as hosts. The first of these hosts arrived on Earth 1 million years ago and began their experiments on the humanoids here at the time. Because of this, two new species were born, Eternal and Deviant. The Eternals were gifted with superior genetics and cosmic energies, and thus were intended by the Celestials to be the protectors of Earth. However, the Deviants had unstable genetic codes, which brought on mutations as the years passed. Although hidden away in Olympia, they would from time to time live among humans in a disguised form, sometimes out of curiosity or for fun, occasionally revealing their real abilities. They are also immortal, as when one of their bodies dies, their consciousness is reborn into a new body created in a machine they call a reactivation chamber. As intended for them from their creation, the majority of Eternals have always protected the human race and created extremely advanced technology. Not all of the race agreed with this though, as a civil war broke out when some felt that they should conquer other species, with one side led by Uranus and the other by his brother Cronus, the once ruler of the Eternals on Earth. When Cronus' side won the war, Uranus' defeated faction left for Saturn's moon Titan, the later home to Thanos, where they built a colony. During this time, scientists from the species Kree, Ronan the Accuser being one of the race you're probably familiar with, arrived on Earth and performed genetic experiments on some humans, thus creating the Inhumans, beings the Eternals have later helped out. Meanwhile, due to release of cosmic energy from a Cronus experiment, the Eternal city, Titanus, was destroyed, but, on the plus side, activated latent genes in the Eternals which revealed godlike powers due to the large amount of cosmic energy they could channel. Unfortunately, this also destroyed Cronus' body, but not his mind, so new leader in Zuras was chosen to become the new Prime Eternal. Under his rule, three new cities were built for the Eternals to inhabit: the mountaintop city of Olympia, the most famous, where some ancient Greeks would confuse the beings with gods of the Olympian pantheon, Polaria in Siberia, and Oceania in the Pacific. At some point in time, the Eternals came into battle against Apocalypse, defeating a powerful mutant and wrongfully believing him to be dead. They also encountered Thor at one point, but this memory was erased from his mind. Considering the long history of Marvel, they have rarely made appearances in other titles. After forging their own worldwide government, destroying any human resistance, the Deviants decided to try and challenge the Celestials, who had returned as the second host. but they failed, and as a result a large portion of their population were eradicated and humans were left to evolve. The home Lemuria was also bombed, causing both continents of Atlantis and Lemuria to sink under the sea. Meanwhile, up until now the Eternals largely kept to themselves, worried their abilities would scare man, but decided to reveal themselves publicly to humanity, offering their vast knowledge. Later, when the Celestials came back for the third host around 1,000 years ago, where they were worshipped as space gods by many of Earth's developing cultures, including the Incas, it was decided by them that both the Eternals and Deviants would no longer interfere with humans, who are now the dominant species, until the fourth host. So the Eternals kept an eye on important events occurring on Earth for the Celestials until their return, never aging as the years, even millennia, passed by. Understandably seen as gods by mankind, for the most part remaining in the background. When a significant number of Eternals gather, they can transcend their earthly form and combine their powers to merge into a single being that is known as the Unimind, which has come in very handy during harder battles. The first of the Eternals that we're introduced to, and the main protagonist of Kirby's run. More down to earth and humble than most of his companions, and invulnerable to most forms of injury due to his complete mental control over his physical form. He can also project beams of cosmic energy from his eyes, and like the other Eternals, teleport silently. He took the name after his son, Ikaris, who tragically died when he flew too high and lost consciousness when using mechanical wings and fell to his death. He's been portrayed by Game of Thrones' Richard Madden in the upcoming film and should obviously be a major part of it. A fierce master tactician and combatant, Thena is one of the toughest warriors from her race, also the daughter of Zuras, monarch of the Eternals. Due to her serving as a representative for Athena, Zeus's daughter, she was often mistaken for her, and supposedly the city of Athens was actually built for her, not the goddess. Much later, she encountered a deviant named Crow, who as time passed she grew very close with and they had an intimate relationship, which didn't last due to her vast differences and issues between their species. After her father's death when battling the Olympian gods, she took on the role of Prime Eternal, the leader of her people. Many years later in the current day, after having her memory wiped, she is married to a human, Thomas Elliot, with whom she has a son, Joey, and is working for Stark Enterprises as a researcher. Like so many other Eternals, she regains her memories and powers. Like the other Eternals, she possesses superhuman strength, speed, durability, reflexes, and can fly. She can also use heat vision and psionically alter the molecular structure of objects and thus alter her appearance and create illusions, among other abilities. She'll be played by Angelina Jolie in the movie, and I'll be interested to see how much of her character from the books they utilise, especially her relationship with Crow. Sersi, my personal favourite of the Eternals. Easily the most easygoing of her people, and flirtatious. She loves any excuse to throw a big party. She can also alter the shapes of people or objects at will. She was also a member of the Avengers for a while, after being asked to join by Cap himself, where in her first mission she helped defeat Nebula from Guardians fame. At one point she developed a relationship with Dane Whitman, the Black Knight, who will also be in the upcoming Eternals movie. And I'll be getting to that later in the video, so don't worry. But her most significant romance is with fellow Eternal Makkari, with whom she's had an on-again, off-again relationship for many, many years. So I'll be interested to see if they can play on Eva in the film, where she'll be played by Gemma Chan. More recently, she was asked to rejoin the Avengers, but declined, and left the world of heroics. Son of Cronus and Thena, Zuras was born in the first city of the Eternals, Titanus. Because he was the first of his race to create a ritual for a Unimind, he was then chosen to lead them after his father's passing. The well-travelled warrior has taken on the likes of Zeus and Celestials, and while some of the Eternals have settled elsewhere in the universe, he remained the leader on Earth. Years after his death, he was resurrected by a machine beneath Olympia by the Eternal Sprite, was tricked into forming a union mind of Ajak, powered by the Dreaming Celestial. A renegade celestial that was exiled by his fellow kind when he disagreed with their plan to turn the Earth over to the evil species known as the Horde. With his spirit trapped in the vial, to rewrite reality, making the Eternals all human and erasing their memories. When Zuras finally had his memories and powers restored, he snapped Sprite's neck as retribution. Pretty rough. The character hasn't been announced for the movie, which seems odd considering what a major part of the Eternals' history he's been. But we'll see. The incredibly fast Eternal has gone on to become one of the most prominent characters in the series. He's involved himself in many Earth affairs, including being taught philosophy by Plato, teaching writing to the Egyptians, witnessing the Trojan War, and even teaching Elvis some guitar tricks. Yeah, really. When Sprite wiped his memories, he became a medicine student named Makkari. When his abilities returned, he later became the prophet for the Dreaming Celestial, as he's the only one of the Eternals that could communicate with it. He'll be betrayed by Walking Dead actress Lauren Ridloff in the film, and will be the first deaf superhero in the MCU. His name's already popped up a few times, so you're probably intrigued by him already. Unlike the others, he is eternally young and loves playing jokes and pranks, especially on humans. In the modern era, he wanted revenge for having to spend a million years being treated and looking like a child and different to the rest of his kind. So he used the union mind powered by the Dreaming Celestial to warp reality, making himself a normal human so he can finally age. On top of this, he also erased all the Eternals' powers and memories, as mentioned earlier. During this time, he became a child star named Colin, with his own show, It's Just So Sprite. Lea McHugh will play Sprite in the movie. When someone is known as Lord of Flame and Nightmare, you can probably guess that they're bad news. The cousin of Ikaris couldn't be much more different from his relative, the most ruthless of the Eternals. His motives are always self-serving and destructive. Early on, he intends to destroy the Celestials, and later becomes a deputy prime minister, and eventual ruler of the fictional country Vorazika, a nation he despises and whose population he sees as far beneath him. He also uses their army to help gather the remaining dormant Eternals to join his cause and take control of his race. He will be played by Dunkirk's Barry Cohen in the film. This hot-headed Eternal can communicate telepathically with people and manipulate them. He's also one of the only Eternals that can communicate directly with the Celestials, although later on the Dreaming Celestial specifically chooses Makkari as their prophet, which breeds a deep jealousy and animosity on Ajak's part, to the point that he manipulates the powerful Eternal Gilgamesh into savagely killing Makkari. He hasn't always been as twisted though. He also aided the God Squad during the Secret Invasion, where he battled the Skrull Gods. He'll be depicted by Salma Hayek in the motion picture. Sometimes referred to as the Forgotten One, one of the more physically powerful Eternals has been mistaken for various warriors throughout history, including Samson and Hercules. He possesses knowledge for most methods of hand-to-hand combat learned in ancient Earth civilizations. At one point, he was even exiled by Zuras for his meddling with mankind, being outcast to a sect of Olympus. He later rejoined his fellow Eternals in a battle against the Deviants. Years later, he actually joined the ranks of the Avengers for a while, which is when he renamed himself Gilgamesh, at Mr. Fantastic's suggestion. At one point years later, he was also the flatmate of none other than Hercules, after crashing at his place to recover from rougher days. So maybe the Forgotten One could be a way to get Herc to finally make his way into the MCU. Here's hoping. That or the Loki series, maybe. He'll be played by Don Lee in the movie. He is an incredibly intelligent inventor and engineer who has built most of the Eternals' machines. Unlike the majority of Eternals though, he has a hesitancy towards violence. This caused him to leave his race and work as a chief engineer of a steel mill in West Germany. Not as much is known about his origins, but he'll also be in the film, being portrayed by Brian Tyree Henry. probably not as well known as the others on this list. Kingo is an Eternal hailing from a Japanese settlement of the race. Living during 16th century Japan, he learned the ways of the samurai, but later used his skills to become a big action film star in Japan. In the film, it said he'll be a popular Bollywood film star to blend in with mankind, portrayed by the big sick and Silicon Valley's Kumail Nanjiani, which I'm really looking forward to. The ruthless military leader of the Deviants, who held a deep love for his former love Thena, who has also had twin children, Donald and Deborah Ritter, with. Although Thena never actually gave birth to them, she instead teleported him into a human, Mrs. Ritter, who was unable to have her own children. He also has the ability to shapeshift, which he's hidden from his fellow Deviants so he can pretend to be a long line of fathers and sons, and which he has used to take the form of the devil to influence and scare humans. While he's not as indestructible as the Eternals, he does possess superhuman traits similar to them. He hasn't been announced for the movie, but I wouldn't be surprised if he's involved. Also known as Ransak, originally only taught by his fellow Deviants how to fight for their brutal combat arena, the Reject is understandably aggressive and suspicious of people when he escapes from the shackles of the Deviants with the aid of Thena and brought into the Eternals community. Unlike the rest of his species, he's handsome with human features, so he was shunned by his people, but fits in with the Eternals. Later, after most Eternals departed Earth, he stayed behind and trained with Kingo Sunen in the way of the samurai. He was also captured by Apocalypse and briefly mutated into a lava man, but was changed back with the aid of the Eternals. After Sprite's spell stopped, he disappeared for a while, but eventually returned to the Eternal City. Brother Tode's mysterious origins, but after marrying fellow Deviant Vera, whom he had a son Reynar, he eventually became the leader of the Deviants. Under his rule, they have attempted to take out the Celestials and Eternals, both unsuccessfully. While he has no powers, he is a skilled tactician. I can only presume that Deviants will play a pretty relevant part in the film, and I'd be surprised if Tode doesn't make an appearance. Yes, don't go typing that he's not involved with the Eternals, I am aware. But he has been announced for the upcoming film, so I figured I might as well add a bonus bit for the character. The wield of the magical sword Ebony Blade has for centuries held the title of Black Knight. Most notably in the modern era, Dane Whitman, nephew to a villainous version of the Knight, Professor Nathan Garrett. Unlike his uncle, Whitman uses the power for good and was even in the Avengers ranks for a long time. Years after his run with the team, the character would occasionally pop up, become the ruler of New Avalon, a kingdom he established in a reality known as Weird World. He would later battle the Uncanny Avengers here when they attempt to make him pay for the crimes of killing Carnivore when he loses control of the Ebony Blade. Although Dane struggles to maintain his mental stability, it is eventually decided that he should stay in New Avalon after Steve Rogers discovers just how hard it is to control the magical blade and stay sane, realising that Whitman has suffered enough under its influence. He's a curious choice for the movie, but I think it could be a cool one, considering his history and the options it opens up for the MCU. Plus, we have Game of Thrones' Kit Harington portraying him, so he's going to be a significant part. So there you have it. A brief, if you can believe that, history into Marvel's Eternals. I would definitely recommend the trade paperbacks if you'd like to learn even more. I found them a lot of fun. I'm really interested in how the motion picture turns out. Will it be more Guardians or Avengers or something very different? What do you think? Are you excited? Let me know below. And a big thanks if you stuck with me through the whole video. Hopefully I distracted you all a bit during these tricky times. If you've enjoyed the video, then please like and subscribe for new ones. Cheers for watching.